What's the difference between pink noise and white noise? How to generate that noise? How to route it to different buses and channels to check your inputs and outputs and speakers? White noise consists of all the audible frequencies that we can hear from 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz, and they all have the same amplitude. So if you look at the graph, the peak of each frequency is at the same height. Now if you listen to it, yeah, it doesn't seem like they are all equal, right? It seems bright, and it is bright because there's more high frequencies than low frequencies, and also equal amplitude does not mean equal loudness, okay? Pink noise, on the other hand, is also from 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz, but it has equal power per octave, which means if you listen to it, it feels like all the frequencies have the same loudness, but the amplitude of these frequencies is higher on the lower frequencies than it is on the higher frequencies. An octave is just double the starting frequency or half of it. So if you play a note on a musical instrument, let's say A4, which is 440 Hz, the next A above it, which is A5, is double that. So 440 times 2, 880 Hz, that's A5. Okay, A3, what is it? 440 Hz over 2, so it's 220 Hz. If you start at 100 Hz, the next octave above it is 200, 400, 800, 1600. And if you go down from 100, 50, 25, 12.5, okay, and so on. Also, this kind of noise is called random noise because it is not static. Well, duh, right? And what I mean by that is that if you have two different noise generators and you plug each one of them into a different loudspeaker and start generating the noise at the exact same time, and the speakers are misaligned, they will not cancel each other. Why? Because the noise is random. It's not the exact same signal. And if you see the graph, you'll see it dancing. It's being randomly generated. Now, on the console, it's only one generator. So if you send a signal from that generator to two different places, and these are going to speakers that are misaligned, there is the possibility that they will cancel each other. Now, you don't have to worry about that for this video. We are not talking about speaker tuning, but it's good to know these things. Go to the monitor section and then click on view and then click on the right arrow button till you get to the oscillator page. And this right here is what will generate the noise. So right here, you can pick which type of noise you want. This is pink noise. You already know what is pink noise. This is white noise. You can click on the encoder to select it. And you also have a sine wave, which is just a pure tone. Now, I'm gonna select pink noise, but nothing is being generated yet because I need to click on the generate button. And now it's very quiet. I like to have it a bit louder, so I'm gonna turn the encoder to turn up the level of the noise. And right here, in the oscillator destination, you can choose which bus the noise is going to. So by default, it's assigned to bus number one. So if I look right now at bus number one, you can see that noise is going to that bus. So output number one, which is assigned to this bus, will send out this pink noise. If I want to change the destination, I can just turn the encoder, select bus two. Now the noise is on bus two. I can choose any of the buses. I can choose the main left or the main right, or the left and right together, or the mono center bus, or even the matrices. What I just showed you right now is very helpful to check your speakers. What do I mean by that? Let's say you have 16 stage monitors, right? And it's not you the one who connected them, or maybe they are permanently set up that way, and you have no idea which speaker is connected to which output on the console. And instead of like following the cable and remembering which where it was plugged on the console and does it, hey, test one, two, is it coming out? No, just generate pink noise, send it to the appropriate bus. You want to check output number one, put it on bus number one, and you'll see which speaker it's coming out of.
If you look closely with the sine wave, there are two frequencies. And that is also a helpful feature because let's say you are checking subwoofers and you're generating a 50 Hz sine wave, right? But then you want to check your other speakers or maybe only the tweeters, and you don't want to scroll all the way till you get to the higher frequencies. You can just set that upper frequency on the other one, right? Let's say I want to check 15 kilohertz and I can just press on the encoder. Now I switched to the other frequency. So you can set up two reference frequencies and then just switch quickly between them without having to scroll all the way if you want to check another type of speaker.
Now, if this is a permanent setup and the speakers or monitors are always plugged, no one ever changes the connections, you are definitely certain that they are connected to the correct output, but you just want to make sure that everything is working before you start the show. You don't need to check each one individually. You can do that for all of them at the same time.
I'm gonna go ahead and generate pink noise on bus number one. And you can see right here, bus number one has that pink noise on it. I'm gonna then select another channel, any channel, doesn't matter. I'm gonna select the channel and go to the home page, then swipe to the right to the config page. And under the source section, I'm gonna scroll down until I find bus number one. And then I'm gonna select it. Now, channel number 16 is getting its input from that bus. So this noise should get into channel number 16. Why there's nothing right now? Because the fader is low on that bus. I'm gonna raise the fader on the bus, and you can see the noise is coming out of the bus back into that channel. Now, on that channel, I'm gonna keep it selected and then flip fader and send it to all the buses that I have connected, all the buses that I need. Then uncheck flip fader and raise the faders of the buses. And these buses are going to their respective outputs on the back of the console. And I now have noise on all the buses that I need to check whether the speakers all are working or there's something wrong with it.
If all the speakers are working, that's great. There's nothing to worry about. But what if one of the speakers is not making any sound? It's not working. The problem could either be the speaker itself, or the amplifier of the speaker if it's passive, or the cable that is going to the speaker, or even the output on the console, the XLR output. To check for the speaker, it's very easy. Just plug it into something else that you know is working for sure. If the speaker doesn't turn on, the problem is with the speaker. If it does turn on, the problem might be in the cable. Then what can you do? You can just use another cable. Does it turn on? Great, the cable was faulty. Does it not turn on? Then if the speaker is fine and the cable is fine, the problem is probably with the output of the console. So here's how to check all the XLR inputs and outputs on the console.
I'm gonna initialize the console just to make sure that no other variable is getting into play. So I'm gonna go to setup, and then under the reset, I'm gonna click on console. Do you really want to initialize all settings? Yes, I'm gonna click confirm. And now everything is back to normal. Okay, let's start checking the inputs. Go to the monitor section, click on view. Then go to the right, to the oscillator. And now, on bus number one, instead of generating pink noise, I'm gonna generate a sine wave. And click on generate, and set the level to minus 11. And there's a reason for it. This is not just a random number, but you'll see a bit later why it's minus 11. And why am I using a sine wave instead of pink noise? Pink noise is random. So if you can see right here on the meters, it's dancing around, the level is going up and down. A sine wave is static. So whatever the level is here, it's gonna be exactly at that same level. And that's what I want to check the inputs and outputs because I want to keep it consistent. Okay, so if I know that the problem is with the hardware itself and not the level that is going into it. Great, so I generate a sine wave at minus 11 dB on bus number one. I'm gonna go to the bus. This is bus number one. Raise the fader all the way up to plus 10, okay, to the maximum. And then I'm gonna go to the back of the console, grab a XLR cable and plug it into output number one, because that's where the bus is coming out of. Then I'm gonna get the other end of that cable and plug it into input number one. Okay, so now that bus is going out of output number one, getting back into input number one, which is that channel. And if I click on select the channel and click on view in the config section, you're gonna see the meters right here. The reason I set the oscillator to minus 11 is because it's just 1 dB less than the clipping point. Okay, so all the lights are lighting up except for the clipping point. There's still 1 dB to go. So what am I gonna do right now? And I'm gonna keep the output plugged to that same output for that bus and change the input. So I'm gonna unplug right here and plug it into input number two, then into input number three, and check for the levels.
if the level is still consistent on that channel, it's still the same level, it's not less, it means that the input is good. The same level that is going out of the bus is getting back into the channel. Everything is correct. If the level that is coming into the channel is less than what is going out, it means that there's a problem with the XLR input or the preamp. Generate a sine wave on bus number one. Make sure the level of the sine wave is at minus 11 dB. Then raise the fader of the bus till plus 10 to the maximum. Then connect an XLR cable out of the output that corresponds to that bus back into an input on the back of the console. If the cable is fine, there's no problem with the cable, the signal coming back into the channel should be at minus 1 decibels. If it's any less than that, there's a problem with either the connector itself or the preamp. Now that I checked all my inputs, I can plug an XLR cable into any channel, it doesn't matter, as long as I know that the input works for sure. And I'm gonna check with the outputs. So I'm gonna start plugging the other end of the cable into different outputs and see the signal that is coming into the channel. If it's all consistent, it means the outputs are good. If one of them is lower, it means that output is bad. So I'm gonna plug it into output number one and go right here. And there are two ways to do this. Okay, the slow way is to just generate that sine wave at minus 11 dB and raise the fader off that bus that is connected to the output and generate that wave on the bus. Okay, this is coming out, this is coming back in, and this is at minus 1 dB. Good. Then I'm gonna unplug this output and plug it into the next one and then go to the back to the oscillator section and now generate it on bus number two and raise the fader of bus number two and check for it. But this is really slow, okay? It doesn't require any setup, but it's very slow. I'm gonna do it in another way that requires a bit more to set up, but it's much quicker to check the outputs. And I'm gonna also give you the scene so you don't have to set it up yourself. You can just load it and start checking immediately. This might be obvious to some of you, but I feel like I have to say it. Do not do any of what I'm showing you right here on your working scene, the scene that you are using for your gig or your live show, okay? Because this will definitely ruin the scene. So whenever you're doing any kind of checking for the hardware and inputs and outputs, just initialize the console, start from scratch, don't mess with your mix. This method doesn't give you a correct level for the first output only because we are generating the noise on the first bus, okay? So just for the first output, use the first method. And once you know for sure that it works properly, we can proceed with the others. So I'm gonna go ahead and plug output number one into input number 16, then click on setup and global reset console, select confirm. This will initialize the console, everything back to normal. I'm still on setup. Go over to the config page and under bus configuration, I'm gonna select the first preset, which is 16 plus 0 plus 0. Set it, confirm, and now all 16 buses are pre-fader buses, and this is very important. I'm gonna go to the monitor section, click view, and go over to the oscillator page on bus number one. I'm gonna select a sine wave and generate, but this time at minus 31, not minus 11, but minus 31, so we don't clip. I'm gonna click on the bus page and raise the fader of bus number one all the way up. And you can see a signal coming back into channel 16, but that's not the important thing right now. I'm gonna go to channel number one, select it, and click on the configuration section, click view. And right here under source, I'm gonna select bus number one. Okay, so right now, channel number one is getting its signal, its input from bus number one. So it's as if this is the noise generator, okay? I'm gonna select the channel number one, click flip fader, and then go to the buses page and raise all the faders of the buses all the way up. And what I'm doing right now is that I'm sending channel number one to all the buses. I'm gonna turn off right now, flip fader button, and raise the actual faders of the buses. So these are the output faders of the buses. I'm gonna raise them all the way up. Now, I'm gonna go back to the channel page, and you can see a signal on channel number 16, but this signal is coming from output number 1, which isn't correct because I said earlier we are using it to generate the signal. So I'm gonna go ahead and unplug output number 1 and plug it into output number 2 that is going to channel number 16. And now if I look at the meters, you can see right here, this is channel number 16. It's at minus 1 dB. It's not clipping. Okay, I can then unplug, plug into 3, check again, good. Unplug, plug into 4, check again, good. But if I plug into this output, number 8, which I know is faulty, you can see the signal right here is at around minus 10. Okay, and we can check exactly how much is it by selecting the channel, go to the homepage, go to the config, and you can see right here, it's not even minus 10, it's below minus 18. So that output, output number 8 on the console, I know for sure that it is faulty. There's something wrong with it because input number 16 is fine. So the low level is coming from this output. I still have one more thing to say, but before that, if this video is being helpful to you so far, consider hitting the like button. I would appreciate that very much. Thank you. And what I want to say is that if you have a bad input or output on your console, please do not open your console yourself, okay? Just send it to a repair shop. They know what they should do, because I opened my own console and there's a lot of thin, I don't know what they call them, ribbon cables for digital components that can easily snap if you're not aware where they are. So you can open your console and accidentally snap one of the cables. You don't want that. Okay, so just send it to your repair shop. And if you decide to use the scenes that I gave you, after you load the scene, there isn't gonna be any signal right here because that's how the console works. So you have to go to the monitor section, click view, and head over to the oscillator page and just turn on the generate button. Okay, and everything is correct at the correct levels. So even though I saved the scene with this on, when you load it on your console, this will be off. We've talked about buses throughout this video. What we did heavily involved buses. So if you don't have a deep understanding of buses and how they work yet, click on this video right here to learn all about buses and subgroups and how they work and everything about them. So click right here and I'll see you in the next video.